All right, we are recording episode 46. Okay, we got audio, we got video. Here we go. Check. Oh, yeah, give me a check.
Hello. Yeah, I'm good.
Yeah, you're a little loud, but that's fine.
Hey, shut the fuck up!
There's no escape.
My name is Barry Allen, and I am the fastest.
Right, another name
day.
You might know me by.
Storm.
My name is Oliver Queen.
You'll be hearing from us.
From the strategic homeland.
Just call us Shield.
Beware my power. Green Lantern's light.
And here we go.
Excelsior!
The Force is with me. I am one with the Force. The Force is with me. I am one with the Force. The Force is with me. I am one with the Force. Episode number 46. Geek Show. My name is BJ.
I'm Big Rich.
Yeah.
I think you just titled our episode. I usually come up with them after, but I think you got it.
I couldn't come up with anything. I usually try and throw like something out to think about on the show notes, but all I could think of off the top of my head today was Rogue One and more. But I think if you just write that repeating, I think then it works.
I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me.
Yeah.
There you go. So episode 46 right here of the Geek Show. Remember, you can get it on iTunes, Podcastpedia, Stitcher Radio. You can even listen to us live on TuneIn Radio, at least X1, Albany's Online Rock, where we play the episodes every now and again. And hopefully another place after this episode is done.
Yeah, I'm trying to work us up to get us hooked up with the iHeart Media. For those of you who don't know, I work for iHeart Radio, and I'm trying to get the podcast up and running on a couple of our sites here in the Albany area, which, you know, you can get anywhere.
Yep.
But I'm trying to get that up and running for us.
Yeah. So we'll see how that goes. And, of course, you know, we're recording video. We're not doing live stream this time around just because it's getting glitchy and all that kind of stuff. We were just talking about this before we started. Time Warner, the cable provider here, the internet provider, is just...
kind of like internet Nazis, really.
Pretty much. I mean, we were talking about how Fios was supposed to come in, and they said they were going to put in all kinds of you know, fiber optics, and everybody's going to have fast internet, and we're going to, you know, there's going to be competition in that. Yet they took all the money from the federal government and never bothered to put anything in, hardly anywhere. There's like very few areas. It's basically the areas that have the higher income per capita.
Right.
In the capital region. So I guess we know what happened there.
Yeah. Obviously.
What was that Steve Miller song? Take the money and run?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They have to. They'll be getting in trouble. They'll be getting in trouble with that.
Somebody will get them in trouble. I don't know who, but...
Who knows?
Hopefully somebody.
Yeah. So it was a big week?
Yeah.
Big weekend, I should say.
Very big.
For us.
Yeah.
You know, last year around this time, I saw it because my time hop came up, and it said that I was sitting in the theater with my butt firmly planted in the seats watching episode 7.
Yes.
And then this weekend, of course, same thing happened, both of us planted firmly in the seats to see Rogue One, A Star Wars Story.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I need to stop calling it, because that's what it's called. It is Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. It is not Star Wars Rogue One. And
correct.
I think a lot of people were calling it Star Wars Rogue One.
This is not one of the saga movies. This is a standalone anthology movie.
Yeah.
Like the Han Solo movie is going to be, which I guess has already started production.
Oh, I didn't know that already started production.
Yeah, they had just they got Han, they got Lando, and I heard the love interest is I can't remember her name now. Khaleesi from Game of Thrones.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, Han's a scoundrel.
Amelia Clark,
that's it.
I had to think for him.
Yeah. He's a scoundrel. He plays the field. He's a player.
And if it works out where the way Rogue One worked out, you know, we'll see this Han Solo movie end where the next begins.
Yeah.
You know, I thought that was really, you know what? I thought that was really, really cool the way that whole thing did. But we should.
Well, we knew all of that was going to happen.
Right.
Yeah. So.
And it's funny because I knew that it was going to happen like that in Rogue One. And we should say that from here on out, if you haven't seen Rogue One yet.
Yeah.
There's going to be spoilers. We're going to be talking about big things that happen in the movie. When it comes to big blockbusters like this, if you haven't seen it. You know, we're recording this, 4 days after the release?
Yeah, I saw it Thursday. You saw it Saturday.
Correct.
So,
4 or 5 days after the release.
Yeah.
So I think if you haven't seen it by then, like, yeah, I know life gets in the way. I know people don't want to pay to go see these movies and everything. But, man, you just didn't get... You wouldn't get the feeling that we got watching this.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, and there were moments in this movie, and we'll get to them, where I just had, like, chills. Chills.
Ooh.
Like, real concern. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I can't say... And I love the Star Wars movies. I love them. I don't think I've ever watched a Star Wars movie, with the exception of the first time that I think I ever saw Empire.
Ooh.
And ever been really concerned.
A lot of people have been comparing Rogue One to Empire, Kevin Smith being one of them.
Yeah.
There was another article somewhere I read about that they had compared Rogue One to Empire Strikes Back being better, if not on equal footing with it.
I'm going to have to give it another viewing before I can really say it was better, but I definitely consider it to be on equal footing with Empire. If you're saying, like, what are the best Star Wars movies, right now, by comparison, I think that Rogue One and Empire are right up there. I don't think it's going to make the kind of money that Episode 7 made.
Yeah.
I think it's going to, you know, it's going to get close to it, but, I mean, Episode 7 was such a phenomenon.
I actually think Rogue One was better than Force Awakens.
I do too. No, I am 100% agree with you on that one. I think that I liked the characters.
Yep.
And I mean, and not to say I didn't like the characters in Episode 7. I really enjoyed every single character that was introduced to me.
Yes.
Every single character that was part of Rogue One was amazing. The throwbacks.
Yes.
To the prequels and to the sequels and to the animation and everything. I mean, there was so much going on in Rogue One with just things that the Star Wars fan can appreciate. Someone who's not a Star Wars fan can appreciate. There was a lot of awesome stuff happening. Mm-hmm. And it makes me wonder if Rogue One didn't lay some groundwork for what we're going to see coming up in Episodes 8 and 9. You know what I mean?
It was
a standalone. We're not going to see a sequel for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
You know? And you know, it's funny because we had talked about this before, you know, with Rogue One being basically the plot to get the plans for the Death Star to give to Luke and company in Episode 4 to destroy it. You know, I think it was Mon Mothma said right out in Episode 4, a lot of rebels lost their lives.
No, you're thinking Return of the Jedi, a lot of Bothans.
Oh yes,
that's what you're thinking.
That's what I'm thinking of.
But that was something that kind of occurred to me after I had seen the movie, and I was thinking about the comparison in Jedi and Empire, Jedi and Rogue One, in getting the plans and all that.
Yeah.
As she's saying it in Jedi, I don't remember the original actress's name, but she's saying, you know, many Bothans died. And she's kind of pausing, like she's remembering, you know, not only the Bothans, but also the, you know, Rogue One with getting the plans from Scarif. So, by the way, we are in spoiler town right now.
Big time.
So, big time spoiler town. So, if you don't know, but
I thought I got to give that movie 5 out of 5 stars. I mean, for
big
time.
I would agree too. And I think I actually had a couple of people, a couple of friends that I know, never seen Star Wars. One friend, wife of, you know, of another friend, husband and wife, she had never seen Star Wars. He, big time Star Wars fan. He and I have had tons of conversations about Star Wars.
Yeah.
And she finally decided to go. I mean, this before they were married, because they haven't even been married a year yet, but they've been together for a long time. She never went to any of the movies with them or anything like that. But this time around, she actually went and bought the tickets and went with him. And she actually really enjoyed the movie. She loved it.
Mm-hmm.
So and I said, you know, and I got to thinking, you know, this is an actual perfect jump in point for people that have never seen the franchise.
Yeah.
There's no real commitment. It introduces the characters. There's really not a lot that you have to keep in mind. It basically walks you along the story.
Yep.
It's a good jump in. So if you've never seen any of the Star Wars movies, prequels or the originals, go see Rogue One. and you will basically be set up to watch. And from there, if you want to, I would say from Rogue One, go and just do the original trilogy. You know, Rogue One, Episode 4, Episode 5, Episode 6.
Then 7.
Then, yeah, you can jump into 7 if you wanted to. Don't worry about the prequels right away. Not that they're bad.
I disagree. I hate them.
After watching all the... I don't think they're as bad as you say that. Dude, I don't agree.
I just rewatched Clone Wars, and I hated everything about
it. You mean Attack of the Clones?
Yeah. Clone Wars, I loved. Yeah. Clone Wars, the animated, I loved. Attack of the Clones, Episode 2. Of all the prequels, that one, I hate it. Just everything about it. Hayden Christensen, the writing. Ugh, it's just, I hate it. I don't mind Episode 3. I like Episode 3. And Episode 1 is okay. I just hate Episode 2.
I don't think they're as good as the, you know, the originals, obviously.
Right.
But I don't think they're as bad as a lot of people say they are.
I think people try and say that they're like, you know, they're the absolute worst. But the fact of the matter is they exist. They're canon within the Star Wars universe. There's a lot that happens in them that, you know, pertains to the sequels and to, you know, to Rogue One and everything. So, I think that certainly they have their place. I just don't have to like Episode 2.
Yeah. Well, that's your thing. That's fine. But we actually did do we each did our lists of the top 5 Rogue One moments.
Yeah.
And I jotted 5 down, and I had a couple that were like quote unquote honorable mentions.
Okay.
So, you want to go first? Should I go first?
No, why don't you go first? Okay. Lead us down. Start us at 5 and take us to 1.
Okay. So, number 5, and I didn't really rank, I just kind of went through.
Okay.
But number 5 was seeing Tarkin and Leia.
Okay.
Because the CG on Tarkin was amazing.
Yeah.
It looked like Peter Cushing.
Yeah.
Like they brought him back from the dead. It was amazing.
And the voice too.
And the voice was great. I'll have to double check, but I'm wondering if they used the same voice actor that did Tarkin in Rebels.
And Clone Wars.
And Clone Wars.
And he was in Clone Wars.
That's true. That's true.
They would have had to. I mean, he sounded so much like
him. And I'm wondering about Leia as well.
Yeah.
But I had a little problem with Leia. The CG didn't seem as good. It looked like she kind of got stung by a bee or she was retaining water.
I think the problem is Carrie Fisher is still alive and well. And everything, you know, and Peter Cushing is not.
True.
So you really had no choice. But, you know, the way that they had to do that part with Princess Leia, they didn't really have much of a choice. And when I was sitting in the theater when that part happened with Princess Leia and they open up the door and you kind of and you see her from behind.
Yeah.
I was thinking, okay, this, you know, that's what we're going to get. We're going to get this behind view. And then they go right on over to the front and then you see her all CGI and everything like that, which they must have paid a boatload of money to do. But who cares? Disney's got deep pockets.
They got the money for it.
I mean, somebody in the theater, it was completely quiet, and somebody goes, "What the hell?" And I was like, and everybody started laughing because it was just funny. Because I thought the same thing when they showed Tarkin. I thought we'd see the back of him.
Yeah.
Kind of like at the end of Episode 3 when he's standing there, the Emperor's standing there, and Vader walks in.
Yeah.
I thought we'd see the back of him, and that was it. But Tarkin was way involved in this movie.
Yeah, he was.
That ends up showing, that shows up on my list too at some point.
Yeah, that's I love that. I love that. And then my fourth one is Vader in Act 3 of the movie.
Yeah.
The big fight at the end.
I think Act 3 of this movie is better than any Star Wars movie.
Oh my God. It was amazing.
Yeah.
This the third act for Rogue One, basically. I mean, you've got the fight going on and then towards the end, you know, obviously, no spoiler here, the Rebels got the plans.
Yeah.
And we
knew was going to happen.
We knew it was going to happen. It was going to happen. Just the way they had Vader coming on that ship. It was a Mon Calamari cruiser.
Yeah.
The Imperial fleet had disabled. Vader boarded it with a bunch of stormtroopers, but Vader, being in his Sith glory, went all to town on these rebel, you know, these rebel soldiers that were trying to defend against the boarding.
Yeah.
And he, the lightsaber lit up, and then he just went to town. He used the force. He basically threw people all over the joint. And one of my friends who went with me basically made the analogy of Jason Voorhees with a lightsaber.
Mm.
That's how intense
Very
it was.
Much.
And then, you know, just when you know, they tried to add some drama. The door won't open. Help, you know, get help, help, help. And, you know, the guy finally handed it through the door and the other guy took it just as a lightsaber goes through his chest.
Yeah.
And then, they lock it down. The Tantive takes off. And then there's Vader standing there in the airlock with a bunch of stormtroopers behind him, just looking out over the planet, watching the Tantive IV take off.
Peace out.
Peace out, Boy Scout.
Well, we'll see you in like 3 minutes, though.
Yeah. 10 more minutes. We'll catch up with you.
Don't worry about
it.
We'll get on the
Executor and we'll get you.
Right, right.
Yeah. So, but that was my number, four was just that whole sequence.
Okay.
The other one, number three, was basically seeing Gold Leader and Red Leader in the battle over Scarif. I thought, because they basically took some archival footage.
Yeah.
You know, stuff they didn't use in the, you know, in the cuts that Lucas got rid of, and they reworked it and they brought it all back in. And the cool thing was that Gold Leader, who is, I can't remember his last name. His name is Angus. I guess he was actually called in to do some redubbing for it.
Okay.
I believe. Because I was watching, there's this documentary called L Street 1977, which basically talks to some of the actors who played bit parts in Star Wars.
Yeah.
Like Biggs Darklighter.
Yep, yep.
The guy that was in the Greedo suit.
Yeah.
And then, you know.
The guy who was in the Greedo suit.
I can't remember his name. Jeremy Bullock, who was Boba Fett.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, some of these, you know, David Prowse. You know, some of them were kind of bits, but, you know, other actors that you really didn't see or anything like that. And they talked about their experiences and what they did and how they did it and all that kind of stuff. Even Fixer, who was in that cut scene that Luke had with Biggs, you know, Fixer and Fixer's girlfriend there. And so, I mean, they even interviewed him. They found him. I didn't even know it, but he was the stormtrooper that told Obi-Wan and Luke to move along. they needed somebody to fill the costume, and he was there. So they said, "All right, come on out." You know.
But what about my other part? Yeah,
Don't worry about that. Because at that point, he didn't even know it was getting cut.
Right. Exactly.
He had no clue. But
he got Jared Leto'd.
Yeah, basically. But I mean, it's a good documentary. It is on Netflix. Watch it. But that right there, you know, is what kind of got me seeing, you know, Gold Leader, Red Leader. You know, seeing Red 5 get blown up. So, you know, and, you know, a couple of days later, Luke's Red 5.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
There you go. Think about that for a minute.
I know.
And just all, you know, and just all the other, like, all of Blue Squadron, gone.
Right.
Gone. Wiped out. See ya. Because they got trapped on the planet. Mm-hmm. And when the Death Star fired, that was the end of that.
Yeah.
So,
terrible.
Yeah. And then, number two.
Numero two.
Ghost. The Ghost.
Yeah.
From Star Wars Rebels was in the fleet above Scarif.
There was quite a few Rebel Easter eggs.
There were. I even heard, and this is one of my honorable mentions, that Chopper and the Ghost were even seen on Yavin 4.
Yeah, I heard that too, but I missed it. I'm gonna have to see it again.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to see it. But yeah, that supposedly, but I mean, A lot of Rebels Easter eggs in that.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a part there where Bail Organa was talking to, I think it was Mothma.
Yeah.
Or whoever. And they were talking about, once we get these plans, how do we get the plans? You know, they're going to be in trouble and we got to get them out and all that. And he goes, I have a friend. And Mothma goes, your Jedi friend? And I'm thinking to myself, does he mean Kanan? Or does he mean Obi-Wan? Oh, he means Obi-Wan.
Definitely, yeah, yeah.
Because, I mean, we already...
I didn't even make that thought.
Yeah, because I'm like, wait a minute, Kanan's the first one that I can think of because he knows Kanan.
Right.
But I forgot. In episode 3, Bail knows that Obi-Wan is on Tatooine.
Right. And or at least knows that he's in exile. Somewhere.
In exile on Tatooine, yeah. So that's, yeah, and that's how he's, and that's why he's sending Leia to go get Obi-Wan to get help to help, you know, take down the Death Star. Which brings me into my number one top was when, because I had been waiting for it all movie, you know, right up until that point. It was after the big scene where Jin and everybody said, you know, we got to go get the plans, we got to go get the plans, and everybody's like, nope, it's death. It's suicide. We ain't doing it. Nope. We'll figure something out. We'll go into hiding. We'll do something.
Mm-hmm.
But then afterwards, she's going out in the hangar, and Caspian's following her. And then on the loudspeaker in the hangar, you hear General Syndulla to the briefing room. General Syndulla, please come to the briefing room. And I'm like, that's Hera. That's Rebels. And they tied it all together.
Yeah.
And then I heard about, you know, the ghost and Chopper and all that, and that basically just whoomp. Did it for me.
Yeah.
That solidified everything for me, and I was sold on the movie completely and utterly. And
yeah.
You will never change my mind. It's way better than The Force Awakens, and it's pretty much on the same footing as Empire, if not better. Once I see it again, I'll be able to make a better determination on that.
Yeah, so I agree.
That is my five.
Okay.
BJ, your five.
All right.
What do you got? Starting at number five,
so,
what do you got?
Number five, I have written down the Death Troopers, but I wanna change it to all of the other variations of Stormtroopers they brought into this.
Yes.
The Death Troopers were cool as hell, man.
They
just seeing an army of them coming at you.
And they didn't sound, I mean, they sounded kind of weird. You know?
They were just like terrifying.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like a lot of Star Wars The Force Awakens, I think, was geared and marketed towards young fans.
Yeah.
They wanted to get young fans involved, and they really wanted to do that. It was there for us, the tried and true Star Wars fans. But this one was dark, and a lot of it was just so unbelievably dark.
Definitely a war movie.
Yeah, but the Death Troopers, for me, I mean, I love them. I would love to see them in more Star Wars. Obviously, we won't. But man, they were awesome.
Right.
Seeing them with Craddock and everything
Yeah.
Number four for me, I liked them bringing Jimmy Smits back as Bail Organa.
Yeah, a lot of people were in my theater were like, whoa, they didn't even expect. I wasn't even expecting. I thought it was awesome when he just kind of came out of the shadows.
Right. Yeah. Because I think a lot of what you're seeing, and you see, if you watch Rebels, you see it and everything. But up until Rogue One, The rebellion is happening, but they're not really unified.
Right.
And you see it on Rebels, too. There's a rebellion, and there's factions and everything, but there's
different cells.
Right.
Yeah.
There is not a unified force of rebellion, and that's what Rogue One does at the very end.
Yep.
You know, that it unites everyone. Hey, we have to come together if we're going to do this. And you see that, too, with I'll leave it as an honorable mention in a little bit, but I'll get through these five first. Number three was showing off what an absolute dick Tarkin is to everyone.
Yep.
I mean, he basically was like, hey, thanks for building this Death Star, Craddock, and overseeing it. I'll take all the credit for it now. Thanks. And, you know, at this point, he's just a governor and everything.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, Tarkin was just an unbelievable. He's cruel. I mean, there is not, I feel, an ounce of humanity in that guy.
I mean, the fact that he actually had the Death Star fire on Scarif.
Yeah.
Right there, you know? You know, with his own troops down there.
I know.
Blow it up.
Doesn't care.
Just one reactor, just take out the base. Don't worry about the rest of the planet. We can rebuild somewhere else. Just take it out.
Exactly. Oh, it's just, I mean, he is just, they expanded upon that character, which wish that we had gotten more of in episode 4. That's one of the characters in Star Wars that I wish that we had been able to get more out of, obviously.
Yeah.
No, but you know, the way they did it with the CGI and in the book Tarkin, which everybody raved about the book Tarkin.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it, but a lot of it was boring as hell. You know, I liked it. I liked getting to know him and see how he, you know, rose in the ranks and everything like that. But I just don't. I didn't understand the love of that book. It was okay for me.
I never had a chance to read it. So
it's all right. It's all right. It's a good Star Wars read.
All right.
Number two, Donnie Yen's character going right into the line of fire.
Oh, yeah.
To hit that master switch.
Yeah.
I was just like watching it and I'm like,
I am one with the force. The force is with me. Right. I am one with the force. The force is with me.
I mean, just in general, his character is one of my favorite Star Wars characters now. And I can't pronounce it. I can't pronounce the name of it. And I tried to look up his name. Is it Ichna or something like that?
I can't pronounce it.
But it was awesome. I love seeing him be able to do that, and then you know, him together with his friend. It was great, and he brought a lot to Star Wars.
Yeah,
and he brought a lot to Star Wars.
He's done. I guess he's also done a lot of kung fu movies.
Yeah,
you know, martial arts movies. So I thought that was cool, just how he would take out an entire group of stormtroopers. Yeah. That was awesome.
Yeah, it was great. Number one for me is also on your list, but for number one for me was Vader lights it up when waiting in the anticipation, and all of a sudden you see that red lightsaber, and it's just the glow of him, and he just totally kicks ass.
Yeah,
this movie for me showed they did what we never truly got to see in the originals, and that is the fact that Vader is an absolute badass.
Yes,
that's what they're doing in the Vader comics and Marvel right now. Yep. I mean, he is the Emperor's right-hand man.
Yep.
But don't forget, Anakin Skywalker was an absolute beast when it came to handling a lightsaber, going into battle and fighting people. Yep. I mean, and he showed no mercy as a Jedi. He shows less mercy as a Sith.
Yeah, we never really... Even in the animated series of Rebels, where we've seen Vader, he's never been like this.
Well, the whole thing of it is everybody remembers... Because Star Wars has been around for so long. You remember Return of the Jedi. You remember him redeeming himself.
Yep.
And you remember him sacrificing himself to save his son.
Yeah.
And everything. But before that and everything, and I think that is a lot of the gripe with the prequels, is that you see Anakin turn. Well, you knew it was going to happen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Vader is evil. He starts out evil as evil can be. And, I mean, when he just goes through just slicing down those guys...
Yeah.
I mean, that's where... I mean, as he was doing it, I mean, that's where I got major, major chills.
Yeah.
Major chills.
It was... Oh, yeah.
I don't know. I'm going to have to watch it again, but I'm definitely in that camp of saying that I think it was probably one of the best Star Wars movies.
So, if you're just fast-forwarded to this part here, we both like the movie, and we both have to go see it again. So
yes.
I'm sure that'll make our wives very happy.
Yeah, especially since I bought the collector popcorn bucket and soda.
Oh, I almost did that. My friend Zach bought it, and he bought my popcorn and soda, and he's like, I wasn't sure if you wanted the collector's cup. I'm like, well, yeah, I was going to pay you for it, but okay.
Wasn't bad. It's like a tin popcorn container that I'm going to use forever. My brother bought it too. We sat there like dorks eating out of our popcorn things with our little action figure on top of our soda, sipping it.
Which action figure was it?
I got Jin.
You got
on mine, and he got Jin on his. I was really hoping for somebody else, she was. It's fine. It's cool.
My friend got the one Jedha Stormtrooper there.
Okay.
So
those the Jedha Stormtroopers were cool.
Yeah, those were pretty cool.
Those were cool Stormtroopers too. I mean, they're all of the new Stormtroopers that they brought in.
Yeah.
Were awesome.
Yeah.
You know. So
I would have
the ones that were on Scarif too, with the like kind of khaki pants and everything.
Yeah, those ones.
Oh, those they were on Jedha too.
Yeah.
But they were. I just loved it. I love that they can bring it into it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we won't ever see them again. But the comics and the video games and everything gave us like variations of Stormtroopers, and it's kind of cool to see them do this.
Well, we could see him in Rebels. We could see him.
We could see him in Rebels. That's
we could true. See him in the comic books and that. So
right. Well, mean, we won't. We likely, since it's the First Order,
yeah,
we likely won't be seeing them in. And
no, we won't see him in any of the new saga movies. Yeah. So, you wanna? All right. So I mean, I think we pretty much took like half the show for.
Yeah,
rightfully so. Rightfully so. There's other things that we wanted to talk about too. The Spider-Man Homecoming trailer, dropped, and I've watched it a few times.
Me too.
And what's your take?
I think it's the first time, and I put it out on Facebook, and I tagged a bunch of people, including you in it. And it's for me, it's the first Spider-Man movie that feels like a Spider-Man comic to me.
Yeah.
Like I rewatched the first Tobey Maguire Spider-Man over the weekend.
Yeah.
And I still enjoy it. I still think it's a really fun Spider-Man movie.
Yeah.
But at the same time, doesn't feel quite like a Spider-Man comic to me. It feels like a movie about Spider-Man.
Right.
Whereas this feels like a Spider-Man comic. I mean, right down to him and his friend staring at the pretty girl and everything and stuff like that. It's totally Peter Parker. Like being that Peter Parker is like this nervous kind of guy, but then he puts on the suit and it transforms him and he's Spider-Man. And,
yeah.
You know, he's quippy and
he's the wise
tough.
Ass.
But he's still so young that he's totally impressed with everything that he's doing. And I absolutely love that.
Yeah. I agree with that. And I'm one of those guys that was worried about, you know, some of the changes they were making in how they were casting, Mary Jane and all that kind of stuff.
I don't even think Mary Jane's in this movie.
I don't think so. I think that was just I mean, a lot of people were saying it was a big rumor and all, you know, it's all BS.
I think the biggest problem with today is everybody wants to be first to report on something, and that doesn't necessarily mean that they're reporting what's actually factual stuff.
I wonder where we heard that. Let's see. Oh, yes, the presidential election.
Yes.
That's about as political as we'll get, but yeah,
but,
pretty much.
But yeah, and so, you know, you hear Zendaya's cash. Zendaya, however she pronounces her name, I'm not quite sure.
She's
I've heard
Liz.
It both ways. Right, so, but somebody took the ball and ran with it. A long, long while ago, she had posted a photo on her Instagram of her with red hair, and that immediately became the feature focus of it.
Oh
is there
God,
she is
she's
with red
MJ,
hair.
She's
well,
MJ.
Yeah, but that photo was from a year ago.
Yeah.
And they haven't even, you know, at this point when they're reporting it, they hadn't even really started filming yet.
Yeah.
So let's just cool our jets a little bit. Yeah. Obviously, I'm in the camp of I would like MJ to be MJ.
Yeah.
But let's see where this movie goes. I'm pretty sold on it.
I was more against, you know, making change for the sake of change.
Right, just for the sake of it.
Yeah,
like,
just because
it doesn't make sense to do it.
We can do it, so we're going to do it anyway. And,
right.
You know, we don't care what the fans say. I'm like, okay, yeah. But, you know, guess what? If I don't like the change, I'm just not going to go see the movie.
Right, yeah.
So,
yeah.
Go figure. But anyway, I mean, but otherwise, I thought the trailer was great. I enjoyed it, you know, the whole, you know, and seeing... You know, seeing Iron Man and Spidey flying through the city at the end, that was, you know, that's that right there sold it for the comic book feel.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing. But yeah, I agree with you. It's very, it feels like a comic book. It reminds me of, you know, sitting down and reading Amazing Spider-Man.
Yeah.
You know, and just having a ball, just, you know, and then wanting more. And I'm hoping that I get that feeling when I see the movie. But and it looks like a lot like I will.
Yes.
So I mean, the Vulture.
Yep, Michael Keaton.
Michael Keaton. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, he looks interesting to me. You know, as of right now, I mean, it was the first teaser trailer. We just got a taste. I want to see more of it. I want to see where they go with it before I pass judgment and everything. I'm still not completely sold on why they needed Michael Keaton for the role. I know everybody everybody loves him. Michael Keaton is Batman.
Yeah,
blah, blah, blah.
Vulture is a lot older. I mean, he's like a really old guy. I mean, older than what Michael Keaton would be playing, I would think.
Yes.
You know, unless they want to say
You know, I think it's kind of something where they've taken the character Vulture in the name.
Yeah.
And we'll have to see what happens in the actual movie. But from what I can gather, like... It's not like it's the character from the comics where it's the old man that goes and becomes the Vulture and gets life or whatever. But I think that they're just taking the name and he's got some sort of gadgets or some sort of thing like that. Because a lot of people thought Michael Keaton would be the Tinkerer. A lot of people think that the Tinkerer is still in this movie, and he's the one who helps Michael Keaton become the Vulture and all this other stuff. Plus, the Shocker is in this movie.
What?
Yeah, the Shocker is going to be in this movie.
That's kind of cool.
And, anybody who has seen Spider-Man the Animated Series, all I hope is that somehow they incorporate that over the top acting scene when he's chasing. Do you know what I'm talking
about?
When he's like, "Come here, Shocker! You can't run away from me!" And I'm just, I hope that somehow they incorporate that just for me.
Just yeah. Well, let's get a hold of Kevin Feige and get that. Make sure
Feige make it happen.
Get it in the reshoots.
Chip, chop, chip. Get it in there. I think it's going to be a good movie, though. I think it's going to. I think what they're trying to do, because after Infinity War and whatever the heck comes after that, I think we're going to see a new Avengers lineup.
Yeah.
Similar to what happens in the comics every now and then. The same lineup can't always be there. These characters have things going on. The actors, in this case, are aging out. Chris Evans doesn't want to play Captain America forever.
Yeah.
Robert Downey Jr., as much as he would like to, can't play Iron Man forever. And I think we're going to get a new team, and I think Spider-Man's going to be a big part of it.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes down. I'm willing.
Yeah,
I just can't wait. This is gonna be great. And what was it? July it comes out.
July that comes out. Okay. May Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 comes out.
Oh God, that was awesome trailer.
That was a great trailer too. What else? And then Thor Ragnarok is in Thor Ragnarok is in November.
Yep.
And then in May, I think it's May or March. Wonder Woman. Is out. We've got Iron Fist coming to Netflix in February.
Jeez.
I mean, then the Defenders later that year.
Yeah.
And does Justice League come out too? Justice League comes out in the fall of 2017.
I think so.
So, yeah, 2017 is going to be a fun time.
It's going to be a busy year for us.
Yeah, start saving your pennies.
Better.
Because you got to save your pennies for the movie, but you also have to save your pennies for all the merchandise.
God, yes.
Because that's how I roll. So, I mean, that's how it goes.
All right. Next up, something I haven't been really looking too much into, but I've started to see the ads for it on television. Legion.
Yep.
Which is going to premiere on FX in February 2017.
Yep. February 8th. So Legion, I'm not quite sold on it. I think I'm gonna have to DVR it and kind of watch it and see how I feel. Legion's a weird character. You know, he's David Haller. He's the son of Charles Xavier. He's kind of crazy. He has multiple personalities. You know, he is what sent the X-Men into Age of Apocalypse in the comics and everything. If you're looking to get familiar with the character, you can check out X-Men Legacy. That was kind of a cool line. I think it's 24 issues. But, you know, it's really deep inside the mind of Legion. It's going to be a weird show. I think it's going to be a really weird show. It's kind of within the Fox X-Men universe. But I don't know if it's all the way in the Fox X-Men universe. We're not going to get any Hugh Jackman cameos or things like that. Because this takes place, I want to say, this probably takes place before Logan. Which also looks like going to be a good movie, but then again, they've sucked me into a bunch of Wolverine stuff that hasn't been great. I still love it, though. I mean, Hugh Jackman could be in the worst Wolverine movie, and he was.
He seems to pull it out for some. Could be he just pulls it out. You know what it is?
Yeah.
It's like he's a pink puppy.
Yeah.
And you can't stop looking at his eyes.
I know. It looks so awesome. And it's going to be very similar to the Old Man Logan storyline. And they're setting up X-23. And I love X-23. She's currently Wolverine in the comics.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know. It's just... I think it's gonna be interesting. But anyway, Legion, that premieres on FX February 8th, 2017. The trailer's floating around somewhere on YouTube. I'm not completely sold on it.
Yeah.
I'll catch it at some point.
I don't know too much about it, so I guess I will. No. I will probably play catch up on it later on.
Right.
All right, so the other thing, going over to the television, the big, big crossover.
Yeah,
with the CW shows. Which was based on Invasion Earth, which was a big multi-title event in the DC universe.
Yep.
And I'm happy to say that I read them all. I bought issues of comics that I didn't normally read because there was a storyline there.
See, I was cool when comics used to do that every once in a while. Thanks, but DC. Every single time now, it seems like, you know, like Civil War II is still going on in the Marvel comic world. And it's not just like I'm buying Civil War II. I've also got to buy all new, all different Avengers. I've got to buy this. I've got to buy that. I've got to buy everything else in the world. And, you know, I'm just not...
It's
too much.
Money, money, money.
Especially since most, I think, Marvel comics are at $4.99 an issue at this point. Ugh. So
Maybe, I mean, this might, maybe this might be a good place to have Ben Morse come in and make a plug for Ultimate Marvel.
All right, convince us to get this product.
Ben, are you listening? Convince us. Is it worth the $10 a month?
I think the DCCW shows, they got this crossover. They've got this crossover right for the most part.
They did.
You know? Yeah. I enjoyed it. If you watch like the CW shows, like the main ones, if you watch Flash, you watch Arrow, you watch Legends, I don't think that you necessarily needed to watch Supergirl.
No.
You know, because her episode wasn't really involved with it until the very end. There were little tidbits here and there.
It started the storyline because Barry and Cisco showed up in her apartment.
Right.
And that's pretty much it.
My whole thing with this crossover was, they're battling aliens.
Yeah.
They bring Supergirl in.
Yeah.
Why did they not bring Martian Manhunter in? Why didn't they bring Superman in? Like, let me go grab my cousin
real
quick.
Why didn't they?
Right. So, and I have loved the Martian Manhunter stuff that they've done so far this season. You know, I thought that they really jumped into the Ms. Martian thing.
Yeah.
They didn't hold back on that at all.
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of weird what they were doing to him, though.
Yeah.
When they gave her the blood and turned him into that. But the winter finale was kind of cool. You know, they introduced us to Mon-El, who was in that ship at the end of season one.
Yeah.
And now apparently, you know, people are looking for him. And they kind of laid the groundwork for that. So that'll be the second half.
Yeah.
Supergirl's a lot of fun.
Supergirl is a lot of fun. I mean, I look past some of the campiness just because they're fun shows.
Oh, you mean like when he says, Hank Henshaw is dead. I'm Cyborg Superman. Like,
yeah.
Wait, what?
Wait a minute.
Why are you Cyborg Superman? Like, that's not how this works. Like,
you get Kevin. You know what? Just get Kevin Smith in there. I'm betting he could write some really good episodes.
Oh,
He did a good job with Flash.
I would have been fine with it if they just left him as he's the actual Hank Henshaw and he's a cyborg now, because he was put together by Cadmus and whatever.
Yeah.
But to turn him into Cyborg Superman, I just don't get it because the whole thing it doesn't fit with. I mean, the Cyborg Superman story from the comics. I mean, Hank Henshaw is like basically his intelligence is in a computer. He transports himself into Superman's birthing chamber and then just develops all of, you know, he turns himself into Clark Kent, Superman, just because Superman at that point had been killed by Doomsday and everything. I mean, he's a pretty badass villain in the comics and everything, but I thought that he was real campy on the show.
Campy.
No need for that at all.
I can look past it here and there, but there's just times where you got to be like, oh, come on.
Really? I would really like it if, and I know they don't really have much of a choice on some of these TV shows. I wish that they would stop breezing over villains so easily, like Metallo in the beginning. I loved Metallo. Like, I think Metallo was great, and they kind of. You know,
I mean, my thing is too. I mean, it seems like they're taking a whole bunch of Superman storylines
and they're
just making them into Supergirl storylines.
Yes.
It'd be nice if, I mean, they've already cast Superman. They've already had him in like two or three episodes of the show.
Yeah.
Just have him as a more of a recurring character now. I mean, it focuses more on Supergirl, but seriously, just you know, have him in there a little bit more often. If you're gonna have Superman villains,
yeah.
You know, and you're going to put him up against, you know, Kara. Just, come on.
I think that Supergirl's best stories in the comics is when she is fighting with Superman.
Yeah.
That's the problem. Yeah. I think they
should start coming up with some new ones, seriously. Yeah. I mean, I've enjoyed the show up until this point. I haven't really got any other complaints
about
it.
But it's like you said, they're Superman stories.
Yeah, they're more like Superman stories with Supergirl. Like, you know, like with the whole alien that made her think she was back on Krypton.
Right, exactly.
You know? Yeah, so.
That was taken right from Alan Moore's Superman Annual. Yeah. So, I mean.
So there you go.
Yeah. I mean, I have enjoyed it a lot and everything, but I see what you're saying. Yeah, absolutely. It's a very big focus on Superman while they can't use Superman.
Yes.
In the Flash over to there.
Yeah.
This season started out for me. I thought Flashpoint was going to be better than it was. It was okay. But then they bounce back and everything. We're seeing the repercussions of the timeline change.
Yeah.
But then, you know, we got introduced to Savitar, a.k.a. Megatron.
Yeah.
you know what I mean? But Savitar, it's funny because they're taking this character who was, I mean, very minimally involved in the Flash comics, and they seem to be turning him into a big bad.
Yeah.
You know, for the most part, where Alchemy is using the Philosopher's Stone to give people who didn't have powers in this timeline powers now.
I'm still kind of wondering how Draco got this Philosopher's Stone from Harry.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Isn't that so stupid? So they cast Draco Malfoy as the guy using the Philosopher's Stone on the Flash?
Yeah.
I mean, give me a break.
Shut up, Potter.
Yeah, I know.
The way he was talking to Barry when he was ticked off at him.
That guy is permanently cast as an asshole. He is. Remember The Rise of the Planet of the Apes or whatever?
I didn't even see him in that.
Rise of the Planet of the Apes. He played nothing but a dickhead zookeeper.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Remember? Okay, yeah.
Like, that's what he did. And then monkeys immediately went after him first because, you know what? You're an asshole.
Why is he? I don't know. I think he's being pigeonholed.
Typecast.
He better talk to his agent here.
He's not quite, you know, on Flash, he's not quite a jerk. I think, you know, he's kind of brainwashed and everything, the whole Savitar things, but that's a weird angle. We're going to have to explore that a little bit more. On Arrow, we've got another weird angle, this Prometheus guy.
Yeah.
He's definitely the big bad of the season. He's been wreaking havoc using his 1980s video game music theme song or whatever. That's a very weird theme song every time he kills somebody. You know what I mean?
Yeah, are you expecting Q-Bert to just come out and start swearing?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
But then, you know, we left Arrow with basically, I believe, wasn't the team kind of disbanded, you know? But Laurel was standing in the Arrow cave.
Yep.
And she's alive. So how do you think that happened?
I don't know. I mean,
they've been mourning.
It can't be Flashpoint because that doesn't register. I honestly don't know. Berlanti's got me on this one.
Now, here's one thing that my wife actually told me because she is very into the CW shows.
Yeah,
and most of that is thanks in part to Stephen Amell doing the Salmon Ladder during season.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Just pure raw hormones right there. Yeah.
I mean, he looks. I'll say it. He looks good doing it.
It's okay, Vera. This is perfectly natural.
Now you understand why everybody likes Megan Fox.
There you go. Well,
it's not exactly acting ability.
We're gonna have to use that next time our wives are.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Exactly. So she said somebody laid out this theory that it's actually that Black Canary from the other Earth.
Oh,
that Prometheus went and got her from wherever she at Star Labs where she was being kept.
Oh, okay.
And he's gonna use her as like a weapon against them, kind of like how he was using Artemis.
Okay. And everything.
Which, you know, I liked that they had brought Artemis into it, but they had her switch so damn fast.
Yeah, that was kind of anticlimactic.
I also hated that angle, the angle that they're playing of like, well, the hood, he was a killer, so you killed people and everything like that. And it's guys, like, stop your crying, deal with it. He's the Green Arrow now. Like, calm down. Yeah. Like, just shut up.
Shut up, people. Shutting up.
Legends of Tomorrow, which has turned out to be one of my absolute favorite television shows because it's just, I never know what's going to happen on it.
I kind of got, through the first season, I kind of got a little antsy on it. And then.
Well, because it was the same thing. It was, you know, hey, we're chasing him. And, we got away. And, we got to chase
him
again.
We're going to get Vandal Savage. Yeah, right. Rah, rah, sis, boom, bah.
Well, that's what I think this season is so much better because every single episode is different. They've brought Commander Steel into it.
Yeah.
And he's more well done in that role than they could have ever done Colossus in any X-Men movie.
Yeah.
It's just really interesting to me. You know, you had to deal with the whole thing where, you know, Ray Palmer had to destroy the Atom suit in order to save time, basically.
Jonah Hex.
Yep. Jonah Hex has been brought into it, which I think is awesome.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of really cool things that they do. And then, of course, the big thing at the end of that one was, you know, we've all been wondering, where the heck is Rip Hunter? Where is he?
Yeah.
And then we see this dude who looks a lot like Rip Hunter.
In a director's chair.
Right?
In California.
Talking in an American accent.
Directing some type of Legends of Tomorrow movie.
Right.
Which is kind of weird.
What happened to Rip Hunter? Was he somehow placed in a different time? And does he not know who he is? Or is that just happened to be like an ancestor or something like that?
Possible. Maybe,
you know what I mean? Maybe. So, I mean, they left us with that big cliffhanger, which I think was really cool. The Legion of Doom.
Legion of Doom.
They kind of formed with Eobard Thawne and, Blondie Magic guy from Arrow. What
the heck is Damian his name? Dark.
Damian Dark.
Wow.
I couldn't remember his name. And, of course,
Blondie McMagic guy. I like that better.
Blondie McMagic guy. I should come up with these names.
You should.
I should. Cisco.
Cisco could definitely use a little help in that, man.
And then Malcolm Merlyn, who has been walking the line between good and evil Arrow.
That dude's got a perforated ass because he's been sitting on the fence so much.
Very, very much so. But I think he's finally, you know, he acts within his own best interests.
Yeah.
And, you know, at this point in time, he thinks that being evil is his own interest. So
he's basically chaotic neutral, I think. Yeah. So
yeah. I just think they didn't have anywhere else to go with him on Arrow, so they moved him over to Legends of Tomorrow to be with these guys. Of course, Damian Dark is a past version of Damian Dark because Damian Dark is dead.
Yep.
Is this a past version of Malcolm Merlyn? Or maybe? Is this a current version that Eobard Thawne went and got?
I don't know, because he lost his hand.
Right. Did he have both hands?
I think he did.
I can't remember.
I don't know. So I can't remember. I'm gonna have to go back and look.
Yeah. So we'll have to check that out. But all these shows look good. If you didn't watch this season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I think it's very good. I love the Ghost Rider stuff that they did with it. I like that they really kind of went right into the weird mystical stuff thanks to Doctor Strange coming out. I very much enjoyed it.
I still haven't watched it since the mid-season break last season.
Well, S.H.I.E.L.D. is unfortunately on the bubble of being canceled right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I don't know.
I had high hopes for that show. I thought it was, you know, when it came out, I was all hyped and I was excited because it tied in with the movies and everything. And then they stopped tying into the movies other than just kind of casual things. And it was like,
it's just a lot of force tied in with the movies. I think what they realized was that the people that are going to go see these movies aren't necessarily going to watch this television show every single week.
Only the diehard fans, maybe like you and me.
Right.
And whoever else is listening to this podcast, because only diehard fans listen to this show.
Yeah.
I can see that. But yeah, they announced Ghost Rider and I was like, okay, this might be cool. This might be cool. And then they said, yeah, he's got the car. I'm like, ugh.
Well, you know, it's really well done. And they've actually teased out, they haven't said it, but they've teased out Johnny Blaze quite a few times.
Right.
With everything. So, you know, we're looking at that. And it could be Danny Ketch or it could be Johnny Blaze. It looks like to me it's Johnny Blaze.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I just think that S.H.I.E.L.D. is, I don't want to say an acquired taste. I mean, they just announced that they're going to be doing an Inhuman show.
Right.
And they said that Inhuman show will not be a spinoff of S.H.I.E.L.D. And that's going to involve the royal family. So they're not doing the Inhumans movie. So if S.H.I.E.L.D. fails, they announced that they were doing that spinoff series with Mockingbird and Hunter. And that didn't get picked up.
That didn't get picked up.
I think that there's something, not wrong, but something that they're just not really feeling when it comes to Marvel television. Netflix clearly has it right.
Netflix knows what they're doing. Right. I think what they should do is they should move all the Marvel stuff to Netflix.
Yeah.
And just do it there because you've got way more creative freedom in that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you look at all the, you know, Daredevil and Jessica Jones and Luke Cage and all that. I really, really think they should consider moving that stuff off of broadcast TV and putting it on Netflix, just because you got more to work with, more to play with.
Yeah,
I know. You can do more things. You can get as dark as you need to and really bring in all that, and you can tie it in with those shows and then, you know, still have some tie in to the movies here and there. Because I mean, with Jessica Jones and Luke Cage and all that, they pretty much, I mean, they've been mentioning the movies, you know, The Event in New York or, yeah. you know, those kinds of things. And you know that these guys are like the street level heroes. They're not the ones that are going to take on Thanos.
Right.
You know,
so they might.
But they might. Yeah, they might be like the backup guys to kind of help, you know, give them support.
I wouldn't mind having Iron Fist taking on Thanos.
That would be kind of cool to see. I wouldn't mind seeing that.
I mean, he'd get his ass kicked, but.
Yeah, he would. But, you know, that still.
But he did beat up a dragon.
I really. Was it Fing Fang Foom?
No. Shang Long. I don't know. Shang Long.
But still, I mean, they should really. I really think they should take all that stuff and just put it on Netflix to. So they can give it the proper due, because I just think they're kind of, you know, it was okay the first couple seasons with S.H.I.E.L.D., but now it's like kind of hamstring.
They've totally gone off in their own direction.
Yeah,
like really nothing.
Yeah.
Besides their talk of the Sokovia Accords and things like that.
Yeah, that kind of crap.
Nothing really. Nothing really ties into the movies. I mean, they've got Jeffrey Mace is the head of S.H.I.E.L.D. at this point. But, yeah. He's such a, you know, he's such a deep character into right. Marvel. Like, unless you're a real comic book nerd, I mean, you're not going to know who he is.
Yeah.
And everything. And what they've done by not being able to be with Fox is that they've taken anybody with any sort of power, and that person is either mystically controlled or they're an inhuman, basically. There's no, you know, mutants or anything like that. They're either enhanced due to mystical properties like Scarlet Witch.
Yeah.
Or... they are an inhuman.
Yeah.
So I think that kind of kills a lot of momentum.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's all because, you know, Fox owns, you know, the mutants.
And then there's confusion, too.
Yeah, exactly. So, but I mean, how many times did really mutants, you know, really cross over, you know, like X-Men crossed over with Avengers and all that kind of stuff? Only for the big things.
And it wasn't like the whole team, you know, like you had like, you know, Beast was in there and stuff like that.
X-Men was like their own separate universe.
Yeah.
And I think that's how...
I think they have to be.
I think that's how they should, you know, kind of, you know, work the deal with Sony. Like, you know, we'll mention mutants, you mention, you know, Inhumans and all this other stuff.
Right.
This is how it goes, but we don't really have any kind of crossover except very rare instances. And honestly, I think because Spider-Man works so well, I mean, with Sony, I gotta think... They got to seriously be thinking.
Well, no, Kevin Feige came out and said that there's really nothing in the future, nothing really going to be happening where they're going to cross this over. Just a few weeks ago, he came out and somebody asked him about it, because there are all these constantly rumors.
Yeah.
It's what we were talking about before. Everybody reports on it, it might not actually be true. And he said, like, you know, like the talks have happened and everything, but there's no plans right now to do anything. I mean, X-Men is kind of on the way out. I mean, after Age of Apocalypse, X-Men Apocalypse, not Age of Apocalypse.
Yeah.
I think that they kind of hit a wall again as far as X-Men movies
they
go.
They have.
You know?
So I don't know what can they really
At
do
that with. Point, I mean, I don't want those characters involved, you know?
Yeah.
We already had Quicksilver in the MCU.
Yep. And he's dead.
Right. Even though he was way better done than Fox.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah, thanks, Joss.
Freaking jerk. All right. So I think that pretty much covers everything.
Yeah.
So quick shout out, though, to Jack Googans. I went to see Rogue One with his dad, Dave. And he said, you know, Jack listens to the podcast all the time. He likes the podcast. So I figured I'd give him a shout out.
Hey.
So thank you, Jack. Spread the word. Tell all your friends about us. Tell them, you know, they got to listen. And if they don't, they're big, fat, poopy heads, I guess. I don't know.
Way to go.
Yeah. So make sure you, you know, like us on Stitcher and iTunes and, you know, give us some feedback. We'd love to hear from you as well, because, you know, that's what helps us keep making the show better and that kind of thing. So for BJ and myself, that's it for this episode. Stay geeky.